Mark Thompson joins us. You are one of my, I don't want to say oldest friends, but
we've known each other a long time.
We have. And you are an esteemed broadcaster, an award-winning television and radio personality. But not only that, you've created and sold some of America's favorite television shows, including The Bachelor. Right?
That is true.
And
yes, that's true.
And Who Wants to Marry a Millionaire? And you were the voice of Fox and ABC.
American Idol's probably my biggest brand that I was the voice of.
I hear you all the time on True TV, narrating reality crime shows, and you're a busy, busy man.
Yeah, David, I'm quite impressed with myself, and after that introduction, I'm even more impressed with myself.
And for years, you are the weatherman on Fox News in L.A. and KFI. You host on KFI and do the news on KFI. And today's guest is Phil Hendrie. Now, I am not as articulate as you. All I am is terrified of talking to Phil Hendrie. And one of the things that occurred to me is we have listeners all over the world who may not know how important Phil Hendrie is. Could you articulate the importance of Phil Hendrie, please?
First, it astounds me that you have listeners all across the world. I'm a regular listener to your show, and the length of your show alone discourages me from coming back week after week, but somehow I do. But I will tell you that you get the most terrific guests, and your conversations are so awesome. I really love your show, and today will be no different if you've got Phil Hendrie coming up, because Phil Hendrie, to me, is one of the true inventive geniuses of the broadcast medium. And I know we use the word genius a lot in the culture that overhypes everything, but this guy created a whole universe of within the genre, within the universe of radio, his own universe of characters, of different realities, and everyone was appreciating it on a different level. And here's what I mean by that. Phil Hendrie came on like a traditional talk show host. You'd listen and it sounded like a talk radio show, like exists in every market in America. And then as he began to bring experts on different subjects, something began to hit you. He himself was doing the voice of the various experts that we would have come on, and he would even do the voice of callers sometimes. So you have him playing the host, him playing the voice of the expert, and playing the voice of the callers. But that's, were it just that, it would be genius and insane. But it was even better, because the whole thing played right down the middle to begin. And he would start with an expert sounding quite informed on a subject, sounding quite sane on a subject. And then slowly, Hendrie geniusly, and this really was the art of it, he would just tweak it over a little bit so the expert would say something that was like, that's an odd thing for someone to say. And then he would crank it over a little bit more, and you'd go, wait a minute, did that guy just say that? And by the time you're 20 minutes into an hour, you're thinking, this is crazy. Who is this person who he's talking to? And other callers are then calling, going, who are you? How can you say these things? I mean, and Hendrie and his, quote, guest, and even Hendrie as a host, began to reprimand the, quote, guest. And again, the guest is Hendrie, okay? Mm-hmm. He's playing a character. It was absolutely genius. And by the way, these guests in this world was populated by regularly appearing members of his sort of cast of crazies. So we'd have the guy who's the head of his neighborhood watch. He'd have the woman who is a community leader and her husband as they drive to wherever. I mean, it all sounded so real. And it was that reality, and it was the creating a texture to all of those recurring characters that I think made Phil Hendrie an absolute genius.
Absolutely. You cannot overstate the genius of Phil Hendrie. Bobby Dooley, I think, was the name of the...
Exactly, Bobby Dooley.
Bobby
right.
Dooley was this right. woman who lived in... I don't remember the name of the housing development, but I can remember driving with my kids and not telling them what was going on. And all Bobby Dooley was saying is she was complaining about a neighbor who wasn't putting the Christmas lights up properly. And, you know, he's black, but that's okay. And, you know, I spoke to him about the Christmas lights, and we went over to his house. His wife is black, and, you know, that's okay. And that's all he did for about 10 minutes is describe this conflict. He was doing the voice of Bobby Dooley. And he just kept planting the stink bomb of, you know, my neighbors are black, but that's okay. And within 15 minutes, the phones lit up and it was Katie barred the door.
Yeah, people are calling saying, don't you realize you're talking to a racist, Bill? Right. Somebody's a racist. And he goes, well, that's a big allegation to level. And they go, what are you talking about, big allegation? This woman is an out racist. So you're right. I mean, and you're right to point to that. He gave also his characters these little quirky qualities sometimes. Mm-hmm. Like one of his characters, it might have been Bobby Dooley, who as the caller's making a point, will just sit there on the line and go, mm-hmm, 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 mm-hmm. And it becomes this way of nudging the caller back. And to the audience, it's a wink, wink. That's what I also think is genius about Phil Hendrie. There are a number of times where the audience who's hip to it is getting the wink, wink from Hendrie. But constantly there were new people coming into the mix who had no awareness of the fact that the whole thing was completely phony.
Right. And he told the listeners at the end of every hour that these are fake calls, that he's doing all the voices. As I understood it, he was on KFI, which is the station you're on, and that's a big station in
Los Angeles. It's the most listened to talk station. The most listened to talk station in America is KFI.
As I understood it, he went on KFI, and then they would syndicate the show to backwater affiliates to get the callers. So, you know, you would get
that's
right?
Why you had all those callers from North Carolina. Or
Yeah. He was on like a 5-watt station in Bump Feces, Idaho. And they'd hear this.
Yeah, you have people calling in going, hey, Phil, I'm sorry to interrupt, but I don't think this person's for real, man. I think they're putting you on. And he would say, well, you know, again, that's how can you say something like that? I mean, well, Phil, I just can't believe someone like this is saying some of this kind of stuff. So you have people constantly swimming through his pond who had no sense that it was an alternative reality completely of his creation.
What would you like me to ask him? I know that Tim Bador went to the Paley Center to watch Phil Hendrie do a live taping of his show, and it was sold out. This must have been 15 years ago. And Tim said, did you go with Tim?
No, I would have loved to have gone to that. I've only seen him do a show on various profiles of him, like you know what I mean, like somebody that a news profile of him or something like that.
How seamlessly he moved from voices. It was beyond anything you can imagine. The way you would listen to him and know, well, he's doing all these voices. How is he doing this? And Tim said he went to see him at the Paley Center and still couldn't figure it out. Is there anything you'd like me to ask Phil Hendrie?
Well, there are a few things that are remarkable about him, and one of them is that even if you accept this cool premise, which is that I'm going to be the host, and I'm going to create these phony experts, and I'm going to have them on the line, you still have to carry it off, as you say, seamlessly. And the other thing is, like a writer, you have to come up with this every day on a show that's multiple hours. So the reservoir of ideas you need has to be pretty deep. I was very impressed with that. But what I really would be curious about is actually a question, just because I, like you, used to listen to him on KFI, then I listened to him on the other station that he was on when he was in Los Angeles, and I try to turn everybody I knew onto him. And I feel like I was an early adopter on him.
Mm-hmm, you were.
But what I was curious about is what happened to him, why he left one station, went to another. I mean, I guess my question is sort of about the business. How can you be as great a genius as Phil Hendrie is and not just write your ticket? Or did he just write his ticket? In other words, I am curious what happened with him from a career standpoint, because it's constantly interesting to me. It's like it never ceases to be amazing that people of that genius can write a ticket, it would seem to me, of whatever they want. And I'm always curious what they decide to do and how and what course that career took. I know he's done voices for Family Guy. I think he's done voices for The Simpsons. I'm not sure about that. But in other words, for other animated fare, I know he's done a lot of those voices. Maybe he decided to go in that direction. So what he did with that that great palette that he had, I'd be really curious to know. And what decisions were made and why.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I think Apatow worked with him on something.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly.
I also think that radio has just become insufferable to anybody who's trying to do something original. That's a whole.
Yeah, there's tremendous pressure in radio to, you know, to follow a certain course. And I don't know. I think it's a very, I think it's a brilliant medium because you connect to the audience in a way that you don't. And so that's why I love podcasting. You know, I think that you connect to the audience. Your audience comes back week after week, and that's the hope anyway. And then you connect with them in a different sort of way. There's a comfort level. That's radio has that same thing, but now I think it's being, you know, largely ruled by sort of a corporate structure that prevents any kind of real innovation.
Your podcast is The Edge.
The Edge. It's at edge-show.com. The Edge with Mark Thompson. Yeah, it was a bad name. We first came up with the name The Edge because we were building a different kind of beast. It was supposed to be originally a show that was going to show you how you could have the edge and travel and blah, blah, blah. Then we abandoned all of that, but somehow we kept the name The Edge. And there are a million podcasts called The Edge, so it's the worst name, but we're stuck with it. So it's The Edge with Mark Thompson. If you look for The Edge, 300 shows will come up, but there's fortunately only one that's The Edge with Mark Thompson.
And who's on this week?
This week, and the show, I think, drops right away. This week, there is, you have to understand our show. I think it's not so dissimilar from your model, although you have great guests. We have great guests, too, but sometimes we veer toward things that are just kind of interesting conversations. And this week, we talk to a guy who gave up a successful criminal law practice to become an Uber driver in Las Vegas. And you have to hear his story. It's really cool. So, I mean, and you might think it's twisted and weird or whatever, but how you can let go of a successful world, 13 years, I think, you practiced law in that world and then gave it all up to go to Las Vegas to drive for Uber, you have to hear it. That's in the middle of a lot of other stuff. I also talk about going to see Steve Martin and Martin Short, who you know. We talk.
How was that show? I hear Martin Short and Steve Martin do a show together. I understand that very few people show up to see it, and it's a real yawner.
Let me tell you, I, first of all, love Steve Martin and Martin Short, of course. I know you do, too, and you have written for both. And I paid top dollar to sit in the first three rows of that show, and I'm so glad I did. And then, of course, I messaged the only guy I know who has written for both Steve Martin and Martin Short, who knows them. And that's you. And I say, hey, I'm here, and it would mean so much just to be able to get, like, a, you know, go backstage, get a quick 30-second hi, Marty. Nice show. Thank you so much. You know, this is my girlfriend. And I get no traction from you on that. Nothing on that.
I said, I said, if you're backstage, because I know they have like a VIP thing where you can do a meet and greet. I said, mention my name. And they'd go, oh, yeah.
Oh, my. How about you mention my name and get me backstage? I mean, I couldn't believe that you, I mean, I'm thinking, oh, well, David, I literally met Martin Short at the David Feldman podcast, and he complimented me on a Kelsey Grammer impression I was doing for a sketch that David had written. And I'm thinking, oh, this is going to be easy. This is a chip shot. This is a layup for David. And nothing. And so I end up cursing you, like all your other friends, angry that you have let me down at this one moment. It's such a little favor. Thank you for letting me relive the bileless rage I was in.
So the show was good. Did you go backstage?
The show was brilliant. It is funny. It's funny. It's music. And then it's more funny. Mm-hmm. And Martin Short is, he's got that, you know, grab the mic kind of charisma of a Broadway actor. Steve Martin is sort of a more studied, but also brilliant comedian and performer. And so they make a kind of good yin and yang. Mm-hmm. And then Steve Martin has this award-winning bluegrass group that he is touring with. I have their album. I'm telling you, everything about this show was right for me. I already have the Steve Martin album. I like bluegrass music. I love Martin Short, and I know the guy who writes material for them, and still I couldn't get backstage. David, you're dead to me.
Line up. Line up for that. Yeah. And the show.
I love you, David.
I love you too.
I love your podcast. I really do.
I love the edge. I love you.
Thank you.
And I miss you. And I, when I get to LA, I hope to see you and hang out. And I miss the sketches we did, all the comedy. You know, somebody's curating all the comedy we did. It's unbelievable what we were doing back in LA. It's amazing, the people who are writing the stuff and performing it, and it's all sitting there on my website waiting to be curated.
Well, the early people should know, the early incarnations of the David Feldman show were a lot about sketch comedy, and I remember just as a listener laughing so hard. I used to listen in the gym so hard that I had to get off the exercise equipment because I was going to hurt myself, and that's not an exaggeration. I mean, multiple times. So it was genius. It was great. Now I think the show's still rich and terrific. It's just gone in a different direction. But I love and enjoy your show. I mean, listening each and every week. So I'm a regular listener. And
by the way, I have a lot of new listeners. They don't know who you are in terms of this. You're the voice of this show.
Oh, that's right. You use my voice.
Let's hear you're That's listening right. to the David Feldman radio show, you sad, pathetic hump. I can remember the night
David Feldman radio network.
I can remember the night you came over. My son was there. We were in my home office. My wife bribed you with veggie vegan ziti.
And, that's right, because I'm vegan. So and I have ziti was delicious.
Yeah. And my son and I were watching, and you were in my office, and you went, you're listening to the David Feldman radio show, you sad, pathetic hump. And you had to do like five takes because we kept laughing at that.
Well, first I thought, you really want me to say that? And you nodded, yep. Yeah, I did. And who would know? It's still being used 10 years later.
It's still being used. Well, it wasn't 10 years ago. We have to. Maybe we should come up with a new tagline.
Hey, it's working for you. Go with it.
Yeah. All right. I love you. I miss you. I'll see you soon. And next time
on Phil Hendrie, that's a great guest.
Thank you. And next time you're going to go see Steve Martin and Marty Short, you should have called me and told me. I could have set you up backstage. You could have had dinner with them, hung out. You know,
you're a total lowlife. That was your moment. You'll never have it again. That was your moment.
I love you.
All right, David.
Thank you.
Love you back. See you.
Bye.
All right. Bye-bye.